Before that, yesterday, as I'm sure, as you have reported, I went to the Department of Agriculture so that I could also get a good idea of exactly what needs to be done. Because as I have stated so many times, the question, the problems in the agricultural sector are primary to all that we are hoping to do. We cannot do many of the things unless we can see that the agricultural sector has strengthened. Food supply is such an important part. It is an existential part of our work. And so that is something that we have to be very, very careful with and attend to properly. As has been reported, essentially what we spoke about were the concerns that we have in immediately, the immediate concerns that we are facing, and I'm talking about 6 months, the next 6 months, the next two, three quarters. Yun ang aming pinag-uusapan na pag sinabi naming immediate. And that, of course, when I was in the Department of Agriculture, that was mostly concerned with the food supply in the next two quarters. I'm sure you are all aware of what's happening around the world. You have all seen the effects of the increasing food prices to all consumers everywhere. And this is what we are anticipating could happen if we are not well prepared. Many of the elements and many of the variables that have caused this food price crisis. There is enough food, but the price is too high. The food price crisis, many of the elements, if not all, have been variables that over which we have no control. But nonetheless, we still have to feed our people, and so we still have to find strategies to make sure that those who are in need are supported by the government as best as we can do. So that is this. And then there is, of course, the long term in the Department of Agriculture, where I talked about rebuilding the value chain from the research and development all the way to the retail, which is something I think I've been talking about ad nauseum already. I don't know if you need for me to explain it all again, but it really is just to ensure food supply in the Philippines at a price that is actually affordable. Because we always have to remember, it's all very well having food supply, but if no one can afford it, it's still not hindi pa rin tayo nakatulong sa taong bayan. So those are the things that we discussed. In the cabinet meeting today, parang ganun din eh. We talked about immediate concerns, and then we had to talk about long-term concerns. Because that is, we're trying in as we attend to immediate concerns, we are also trying to streamline the government so its function is better, its function is much more efficient and easier for the public. As they have to do business, whatever business they have with the government, that it is easier and simpler and safer and more secure to do. So these are the different things that, of course, we spoke to it in much greater detail. And I think we will, as I said, I think that we will, I want to make sure that every department, every agency, has already the plan in mind para coordinated naman ng ating cabinet the secretaries with each other. So that's the general gist of my attendance yesterday in the Department of Agriculture and the cabinet meeting that we had earlier today. So I think I will now open the floor to
a
few questions
for Ms. Maricel Halili. Hi sir, magandang hapon po. Sir,
good afternoon.
May we know kung ano po yung most important marching order ninyo to all the cabinet secretaries following the first cabinet meeting earlier?
Oh, you can. I don't think we can do. We can say one. I think essentially is the. We got into much more detail, so there are no generalizations anymore. Kasi we've been talking anyway for 2 months. Matagal na namin pinag-usapan yung mga general concepts and general principles. So ang pinag-uusapan talaga namin is already what we are going to do, when we are going to do it, how we are going to do it, etc., etc., etc. So each department got very different instructions. The only thing that we have to we have to realize how interconnected all the government is. That everything that's done on one hand affects the government in another place. Sometimes not to its advantage. So we have to be careful about doing all of that properly. So there isn't one single one. I suppose if there's one single one, is let's get our bureaucracy streamlined. I gave them. I said I will not. I give you a relatively free hand in deciding who you want to hire and how you want to change the structure of your department. If indeed that's what you want to do. But do it soon, because we have work to do and we have to get to work immediately. I think there are some easy, not naman easy, but there are some things that are immediately accessible in the sense that we can start doing something about it already. The first thing that is an example of that was Indaisara's announcement that we have a plan for full face-to-face by November of this year. September, we will start a phased face-to-face schooling. And that face-to-face will end up in early November, I say already 100% 100% attendance ng mga bata. Kasama dyan, we have to talk about also vaccination, etc., because there are going to be some issues that will be raised. So, as usual, if I'm going to single out one instruction, said quickly, let's get this done quickly. As usual, we're nagmamadali. Of course, we're careful, but we're always in a hurry because we have to get much done in very little time.
Sir, on other issue, are you going to have a meeting, sir, with Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi? And if you're going to meet with him, what will be the agenda? What will be the talking point, sir?
Well, it's the usual agenda. I will meet with him. And agenda, I am sure, will be to strengthen ties between China and the Philippines. And, of course, to find ways to work to resolve the conflicts that we have. And one of the ways that I have consistently suggested is that we have our relationship not only on one dimension, yun lang West Philippine Sea. Let's add to that. Let's have the exchange, cultural exchanges, educational exchanges, even military, if that will be useful. Of course, the GTG has always been there. The private sector joint ventures have also been there. But I think that the more we do of that, the more it will help resolve the issues. I will also mention that it's an important player, an important actor in all of this, in the region, in terms of the regional geopolitics, will be ASEAN and even APEC, because they have an interest. They are stakeholders in this. So I think we can say that we need for those for them, for ASEAN especially, to be active for their member countries. So it's essentially always trying to find ways to improve relationships. And we have many proposals to them, in the sense that, as I said, we would like for us to increase the scope Wag lang yung West Philippines yung pinag-uusapan ng China at saka Pilipinas. Let's do other things too. And that way it will normalize our relationship.
Sir, sorry, last na lang po on my part. When will be the meeting, sir?
When will be?
The meeting.
I'm not sure. When is he scheduled to... Wala pang when schedule yata eh.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Let's keep it down to one question each para makarami tayo. Mr. Neil Mercado, Inquirer.net. If you're not here, the question was, inflation rate soared to 6.1%, the highest since October 2018. Does the President have any concrete plan to address this? Paano matutulungan ng mga Pilipino umaaray na sa taas ng presyo ng bilihin?
Yes, we of course, the inflation rate is a problem, not only in the Philippines, but everywhere. Our inflation rate, anong pinote niya inflation rate?
Right now, 6.
What did the...
6.1.
Yes. I think that I will have to disagree with that number. We are not that high. We have crossed our targets were less 4% or less. Unfortunately, it looks like we may cross that threshold. Tatawid tayo sa 4%. That's why again we have to think about interest rate levels, but there is a conflicting force in that exchange rate levels. The United States, the dollar, has gained against all currencies. So the dollar has gained against all currencies. The specific effect is that it actually will start to be part of the components of the inflation. So we are having to be careful because essentially our economic policy right now, our monetary policy right now is essentially to use interest rates to control the inflation rate. We are not looking specifically to the exchange rates now. What we are targeting is the inflation rate. So that's what we are doing. The increase in commodity prices are again something that happens. That the forces that have pushed the commodity prices up are again beyond our control. Much of our inflation is actually imported inflation. It is imported because it is the inflation on the products that have suffered inflation that we import. So sumama na yung inflation nila dun sa atin. So we have to. When we analyze, we have to make those categorical differences so that to better understand really what the situation is.
Ivan Marina, GMA7. One question, please.
Mr. President, what support can the transport sector expect from the administration? Do we expect more or continued fuel subsidy? No. At gayon din po sa mga pasahero, what can they expect? Patuloy pa rin po ba yung libreng sakay? At i-expand po ba ito? Thank you.
Okay. Good. I'm glad you asked. We just discussed that we are going to try not only to continue the fuel subsidies for the transport sector, but to expand it to include the tricycles. Which up to now have not been included. And so we talked about in the cabinet meeting, we talked about the funding, where it can come from, and how we are going to manage the funding for the additional fuel subsidies. We have enough budget, I think, to last for most of this, not for this year and a little bit beyond. But we still have to find that. We have to find that money if we're going to continue. The Libreng Sakay, what we have done is we will continue the Libreng Sakay. But we are going to stop the Libreng Sakay in MRT3. We will transfer the Libreng Sakay to students. Sorry, I think I'm doing this wrong. We are in Libreng Sakay continues as is. That continues. But what we are going to do is we are going to do a program for the students, because if they come in, we will fully subsidize first their pamasahe. We'll phase it out because we cannot afford to keep that going. But students will ride for free on LRT2, which is going to the university belt. So that's what we are. We extended the fuel subsidy, and we moved the subsidy the subsidy for riders to the LRT2 to assist our students who are coming back in September.
Thank you.
Ms. Bettina Unite, Manila Bulletin. The question was, is there an immediate directive from the President after the DOH reported more than 7,000 cases of COVID-19 in the past week?
Yes. So far, I think we are still, because if we look at where we started, we still have the capability to handle the new COVID cases. Luckily, when we should not look at the number of COVID cases in the same way as we looked at them in 2020 and 2021. Because this is Corona, this is Omicron. This is Omicron. Omicron is very different. It is very, it's a little contagious, but it does not hit us hard. In fact, the general experience has been people are down maybe for 2, maybe 3 days. And that's like flu. It's like having flu. So we are getting to that point where we are learning to live with the coronavirus, specifically with the Omicron variant and the other variants that are coming. Because of this, though, the science has come back to us that for the original variants, mga alpha, yung una, 2020, okay na to have the two doses. That gives you good immunity. But with Omicron, you apparently need a third dose, which is a booster dose. So we will be encouraging that, especially for younger people, because again, we have to be concerned about their return to school. So that's the general policy. We will reinstitute again the vaccination drive, so that we can at least feel safer when the children go back to school.
We have a last question. Lex Demetrio from CNN.
Mr. President, magandang hapon.
Good afternoon.
Okay, let's go to Agri, no?
And to?
Agriculture.
Yes.
So I understand that your desire is to lower prices of food, right? Mm. So are you inclined to approve additional import volumes for rice, chicken, sugar, to bring down prices? And if you have any volume, indicative volume, that you're looking at?
We it has been used, importation has been used as a price stabilization measure. I don't think that is the primary, that is the primary reason for the importation that we'll do now. As a matter of fact, we are going to try. No, I think we will do it in the Department of Agriculture to boost production of rice and corn in the coming two quarters, hanggang Pasko, until after Christmas. Again, because there are several reasons for that. The reasons because we would prefer to import as little as possible. So we should increase our own production of rice and corn. Corn especially became very important because the feed wheat that we were importing, na-cut off ang supply natin, so we have to substitute it with corn. This season, the corn growers were able to come together and provide sufficient feed for the broiler production. But we still have to increase production of corn. to ensure that that supply, because there's also there's corn for food and there's corn for feed. So we are able to increase production sufficiently, then hopefully the importations. We really do not want. It's not really an import substitution measure. It is a strategic food supply measure. But of course, if it's a nagkaka-import substitution, that's not necessarily a bad thing. So that's the plan. Ang sa protein side, yun medyo tayo pilit tayo because when it comes to pork, yung ASF talaga natin hindi natin makontrol for various reasons. So we still have to import a lot of the pork products, not necessarily the. On the broiler side, for the chicken production, broiler production, we will also still have to import because nagka-problema na naman tayo sa feed, nagkaka-problema na naman tayo sa food supply nung mga and it's yung production natin is not sufficient again, and that's why this is really the reason. If you look at it, is our production is not sufficient in pala, is not sufficient in corn, it's not sufficient in livestock, it's not sufficient in fisheries. That is why I made agriculture the highest priority of everything that we are doing. Because you cannot build a strong economy unless you have a foundation of a robust agricultural sector, which assures food supply, even in emergencies. And that's what we're working towards. Yan yung mga long term. Yung mga short term, yung sinasabi ko, increase production for the rest of the year, habulin natin yung last planting for this year. They will mill siguro, they'll harvest soon, they will harvest towards the end of the year, they'll mill soon after that. So baka mahabol natin yung food supply problem doon. But still, those are short term solutions. We need long term solutions, solutions that can take care of this problem. We no longer take care of the symptoms, we take care of the disease. And that's what we are trying to do in agri. We have a ways to go. There are elements kasi nung value chain na nandyan eh. Pero they're not part of a process. They exist standalone sila lahat. So diyan ang gusto natin ngayon, buuhin natin 'yon para may savings yan eh. When you vertically integrate, to use the technical term, when you vertically integrate, ang daming savings all along the line. And that's hopefully gets to the point that we can retail these agricultural products at a good price that's affordable to people.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you.
Thank you all
very much. I hope we were able to answer at least some of your questions. Maraming salamat.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. heading a media briefing, talking about his first cabinet meeting after being proclaimed president. Among the topics he talked about when we caught up with this briefing was touching on education. He mentioned his and Vice President Sara Duterte's plan of full face-to-face classes by December, starting with a phased start by September. He says that they will need to talk about more about that issue in the coming weeks. On agriculture, he incidentally headed his first meeting at the department as its concurrent head to talk about the most immediate concerns for the sector, most especially the food supply in the next two quarters. The president says there is enough food, but the prices are too high. Long term, he wants to look at the value chain to ensure food supply for the country at an affordable supply. Now, in answering questions from the media, among the issues he talked about are the visit of Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi to the country. He confirms that he's going to be meeting with him to talk about improving the relationship between the two countries and resolving conflicts that the Philippines and China have. But he doesn't want to just focus on the West Philippine Sea issue, but also increase the scope of cooperation, even including cultural exchanges. For the transport sector, Marcos said they discussed to continue the fuel subsidy for the transport sector, but they will also expand it to include tricycle drivers. They are, however, still talking about the funding for that. He adds they have enough budget for this year for that and a little bit beyond. The Libreng Sakay has been continued, as we've reported, but it will be eventually phased out. But there will also be a different program for students as they return for the next school year. In agriculture, and ask about possible additional import volume for rice and chicken, Marcos says he wants to boost production of rice and corn until after Christmas, preferring to import as little as possible. He also talked about the country living with COVID as well as inflation. We'll give you more details of that in our succeeding newscasts. Please stand by for Rundown. It's coming up next.